Okay, so welcome to the fifth and last installment about dark matter. So today we're going to discuss essentially about only one thing, which is indirect detection of dark matter. And if we have time, I will try to sketch how the different search strategies that we discussed in these two past lectures can complement each other in some way. So we discussed about direct detection last time, and we discussed a little bit about collider searches. I might come back to that in the end, as I said. And today we are talking about the third main direction, which is indirect detection. So the basic idea, I guess you know already, so is the following. We are looking at the following process. We are looking at two dark matter particles that in some way annihilate in the galactic halo or wherever they are, and produce a pair of standard model particles. These standard model particles will then decay and hadronize and do whatever they want, whatever they need to do according to standard model physics. And in the end, we'll have a production of a shower, a flux of stable standard model particles, ordinary standard model particles, such as, for instance, photons, low energy, high energy, everything, antiprotons, say positrons, for instance, neutrinos, or even more exotic things such as nuclei of antideuterium and possibly even other things. So, for instance, imagine, I'll make some examples later, but for instance, imagine that this is a W plus and a W minus pair. So these particles, being unstable and massive in the standard model, will decay and produce quarks and electrons and neutrinos and positrons and so on. And so in the end, I will have a flux of these particles coming out. These particles are stable, and so they will propagate in the galaxy from the point of origin to us, to the Earth, and we will collect, of course, in very different ways, depending on which kind of particles we are looking at. Okay, so typically people consider dark matter annihilations, but you can also have the case in which dark matter is an unstable particle, and so you have a production of, a decay of dark matter into a pair of standard model particles. So this is exactly the same as this, just with a factor of two, in some sense, according for the difference of the fact that here you have only one dark matter particles in the initial state, and here you have two. Of course, you can have more complicated scenarios in which you have more standard model particles coming out from here or from here. But roughly, to fix the ideas, we can select this as our typical example in which you have two dark matter particles annihilating into a pair of standard model particles. So just one side remark. I'm talking about annihilations of dark matter particles typically in the halo. So clearly, this is, first of all, it assumes that dark matter has some interactions with particles of the standard model, which are hidden in this blob. So the new physics in which dark matter is involved will specify what goes inside this blob. And this I said last time, it's always an assumption. You have to have some interactions with the standard model particles. And second, you might be surprised because I'm saying that dark matter annihilates, and so you might say, okay, so this diminishes the density of dark matter particles in the galactic halo. Yeah, that's true, but the rate of annihilation or the rate of decay is typically so small that it has essentially no impact on the residual dark matter annihilation, the dark matter density in the galaxy. So basically, it doesn't make even a dent in the total abundance of dark matter particles in the galaxy, the fact that they are annihilating every now and then today. Another remark. So here, as you noticed, I focused mostly on, when I talk about charged particles, I'm focusing mostly on antimatter, so positrons, antiprotons, and possibly antideuterium. That's because, typically in the annihilations, you expect to produce pairs of particles. So whenever you have a proton, you expect to produce an antiproton. Whenever you have an electron, you expect to produce an positron, and so on. Because typically, you have a conserved quantum number. So since dark matter has no, say, baryonic number in most typical models, then you want to conserve it in the final state. And so you have to produce a baryon and an antibaryon, or a lepton and an antilepton. This is not a theorem. I mean, you can have models in which dark matter carries one of these quantum numbers, and then you can have an imbalance in the final state. But typically, you produce pairs of particles and antiparticles. However, I'm focusing on the antimatter part just for practical purposes, just because the antimatter is less abundant in astrophysical processes. And so typically, it's easier to detect antimatter rather than the corresponding matter on top of the astrophysical backgrounds. Let's say that protons are in cosmic rays. We'll see later that this is what we're looking for. In cosmic rays are 10 to the 6 in some units, and antiprotons are just 1. So if I want to detect those that come from dark matter, it's better to look for antiprotons rather than for the much more abundant protons. OK, so this is what happens at the annihilation or decay stage. But then these particles, as I said, have to reach us in some way. So let me draw a simple picture. So this is, say, the galaxy, if we see it from a side. We are somewhere here. This is the galactic center. We are 8.3 kiloparsecs away from the galactic center or something like that. And as we said many times, we are immersed in this. So this is the disk of the galaxy, baryonic matter, so a flat and thin halo of baryonic matter, stars and stuff. And we are immersed in the galactic halo of dark matter, which we assume to be spherical and spherically symmetric, distributed as a sphere and spherically symmetric as well. So the different particles will propagate from the production point, so where the annihilation happens, suppose here, so in this point here, to the Earth, right? So particles like neutrinos and gamma rays will propagate in a straight line, of course, because they have they're not sensitive to any other process. They might be absorbed a little bit by the matter intervening here, but typically that's not the case for the energies we are considering. So they trace back the direction of production. Instead, the charged particles, such as antiprotons, positrons, and possibly also antinuclei, have to propagate around in the magnetic inhomogeneities of the galaxy. And then, at some point, they will get to us. So basically, what you have to think is that these particles go around for millions of years, possibly. And sooner or later, and they continue scattering over the inhomogeneities and the little domain walls of the magnetic field, which is all around the galaxy, making a sort of random walk that deforms completely their trajectory so that they get to us after a certain time from a direction which is essentially completely random with respect to the point at which they've been produced. So there is no way to trace back where they come from. Basically, they get to us from a volume of some size, depending on their energy, depending on their species, and so on, centered around us. But we collect them all from this effective volume. So these are gamma rays, neutrinos, and charged particles produced by the annihilations directly. There are also some another series of processes which is called secondary. It's going worse and worse. Secondary, let's say, photons or secondary emissions, which means the following. So when I have an annihilation happening somewhere in the galactic halo, I can produce in this annihilation electrons and positrons, so typically energetic electrons and positrons. And these energetic electrons and positrons, while traveling around in the galactic halo, will make some processes, such as, for instance, inverse Compton scattering, Bremsstrahlung, Brems, and synchrotron radiation. So inverse Compton scattering means that one of these energetic electrons or positrons might hit one of the very low energy photons of the CMB. and upscatter it to much larger energies, so that the electron, basically, suppose that this electron has an energy of some GeVs, says, this electron gives all the energy it has to the low energy photon of the CMB, and what you have in the end is a very high energy gamma ray that is produced in this process. This is the inverse Compton scattering process. Similarly, you can have that this electron or positron might hit one of the atoms in the, say, atom of hydrogen in the galactic interstellar medium, somewhere here in the plane, typically. And by doing Bremsstrahlung, we'll emit a gamma ray, which will be typically softer than this one, but still relevant. So this is also a signature that we can get. And finally, these electron or positrons can, since they are going around in the galactic magnetic field, they will certainly curve the trajectory, so do in the magnetic field of the galaxy. And so they will do Bremsstrahlung, which produces typically radio waves. Synchrotron radiation, synchrotron emission, which produces typically radio waves. So you can get not only gamma rays, so essentially photons, high energy gamma rays, directly from the annihilation product like this, which I will call later prompt emissions of gamma rays. But you can also get secondary emissions of photons of different energies through the inverse Compton process, the Bremsstrahlung process, or the synchrotron emission process. So there are several ways, several signals that you can look at. So the basic principles of detection. Are that we are looking essentially for fluxes of, say, GV to TeV gamma rays, GV to TeV particles. I'm thinking about this range more or less because this is the typical energy which is involved, so the mass of the dark matter particles in the initial state that can be collected on Earth or in orbit, depending on the particle that we are looking at, and for which the main background is, of course, the continuous flux of astrophysical cosmic rays that come from all possible astrophysical sources in the galaxy. So we have to look for an excess of particles such as those ones on top of a much larger background produced by ordinary cosmic rays. So as you can easily imagine, there are many astrophysical sources that produce fluxes of gamma rays, that produce fluxes of antiprotons, positrons, and so on. And so we have to look for an excess on top of this known or less known fluxes of cosmic rays. So typically, the rule of the game will be to plot the flux of some species of gamma rays, say, I don't know, electrons or positrons, try to predict or know what the astrophysical background is, something like this, from astrophysical processes that you think you know, and detect on top of it a contribution from dark matter that sticks out here, and so gives you a signal that something is going on. As simple as that, in principle. Then getting it to work is the very difficult thing.
Question.
Yeah?
In the inverse Compton scattering, the electron which arrives has been generated by some dark matter.
Yes, by the dark matter annihilations.
And so why do you want to interact again with the dark matter photon? Cannot it be another?
No, this is photon? A CMB photon. So this is CMB. So this is electrons and positrons produced by the dark matter annihilation or decay. And these are energetic electrons and positrons, where with energetic I mean, say, GV, TeV, or something like this. And they are around, they heat, I mean, they are immersed naturally in the bath of very low energy CMB photons, okay, which have an energy of a fraction of an electron volt today. And they can upscatter this to very high energies, essentially, say, giving to them, to one of them, all of their energy, so that in the end the photon has GV, TeV energy, and the electron goes away, say, at rest, in some sense. I mean, many of the scatters happen, and in the end you have energetic electrons, energetic photons, and low energy electrons. It's not the only target, actually. You can have also the scattering on the light, which the light buff, the light field of the galaxy. So the galaxy is producing different kinds of lights. Stars are producing different kinds of light, which is rescattered by dust, whatever. So you can also scatter on the infrared background light. There is a field of photons produced in the infrared, produced by light by stars, which is rescattered by dust, or even ordinary starlight. So you can heat a photon that comes from a star, say, and in the optical, and upscatter it to gamma ray energies. So this clearly depends on the background fields, so how much photons of CMB you have, and this you can compute easily because it's uniform and it's a black body. But these instead, how many infrared photons you have and how many starlight photons you have to model the galactic geography and in several different ways and get a handle on how they are distributed around. Okay, so these are the basic principles. Two main points still, really on the cartoon pictures and in the basics still. So I'm saying that essentially there is a source of cosmic rays, charged or neutral, which is diffuse and distributed with a spherical shape around the galactic center. Right. So this the whole dark matter halo is a source, a diffuse, extended source of this kind of particles. The distribution, so where exactly these annihilations happen, depend on the profile of dark matter in the galaxy that we discussed 2 times ago, I think. So you remember that I had plotted those possible, say, plausible profiles, density of energy of dark matter as a function of the distance r from the galactic center, and you remember that we had profiles such as Navarro, Frank and White, or the Kord profile, or the Inasto, and something else. So dark matter is densest here at the galactic center, so more number of particles of dark matter means more likely annihilations, so means say, brightest source typically expected at the galactic center, and it's less dense at the periphery, so the source goes down as the profiles of dark matter. As we see,
so what is the critical distance in R for this type of measure?
This here?
Yeah.
No.
So
it depends a lot on which species you're looking at. Sorry. It depends a lot on which species you're looking at and on which energy you're looking at.
Okay, so if you're looking at the positrons.
Yeah. So if you're looking at the positrons, it depends on the energy in the sense that I have possibly a plot or I can. If you look at positrons at large, at very high energies, say TeV positrons, those can only come from a very local environment of the order of less than 1 kiloparsecs around the position of the Earth. Because otherwise, if they go around too much, they will lose too much energy and they will be degraded in energy and they will not have TeV energies any longer. If you look instead at low energy positrons like MeV or sub-GeV, then you can have a larger halo, which can be of the order of a few kiloparsecs that even touches the galactic center.
Yeah.
So the profiles are very different one from the other. They can have orders of magnitude of difference at the galactic center, so even 4 orders of magnitude for 10 parsecs here, so 0.01 kiloparsecs, even 4 orders of magnitude. And also remember that, as I will say later, if we are talking about annihilation, so it's also intuitive. You need 2 dark matter particles annihilating, and so this will be to the power 2, raw density of dark matter to the power 2. So you have a difference of up to 8 orders of magnitude here between this assumption for the profile and this assumption for the profile. So if you are sensitive to signals coming from the galactic center, then the uncertainties will be huge of this, this level. If instead you're looking, say, for positrons at large energies, you're sensitive only to the local environment. So basically, you're sensitive to this region here, 1 kiloparsec around the, this is the location of the Earth. And basically, here the profiles are under control. They're more similar, actually very similar. And so in the end, the impact on your signal, the uncertainty on your signal, will be very much reduced. So depends a lot on the species you're looking at and on the energy you're looking at.
Sorry, but if you look at photons and you are on Earth, and then you start to span, you have to see an increase.
Yes, yes. So later you expect to see a morphological variation between when you look at the galactic center and when you, say, raise your latitude or look in some other direction, like here. Yes, you should see something that traces rho squared. It's not so simple, I mean, because you have a lot of astrophysical backgrounds that intervene. You have lots and lots of sources of gamma rays at the galactic center. So, but yeah, that's true. I mean, you can look not only at in one specific direction and hope to detect a signal, but even more, look at the variation of the signal with the latitude, which is also a smoking gun in some sense for the dark matter origin.
Because, I mean, the factor is very geometrical.
Yes, for gamma rays, yes.
Independent of the model, I mean, you have a model, but if you start spanning,
absolutely,
you have a geometrical variation.
Yeah, absolutely. So it traces rho squared. You expect if the galaxy was empty, no stars, no gas emitting gamma rays, no crazy stuff, then yeah, you should see the galactic center glowing in gamma rays, and then as you go high in latitude, the intensity goes down precisely as rho squared. And now you have still an uncertainty on which profile you have to follow, and this is also sizable, but yeah, it would be completely clean. That's not real life, because there are astrophysical backgrounds of all sorts. Okay, so, well, now I think I wanted to say something else very basic. Ah, yeah, so the source is this spherical blob of dark matter, as we said. And the other thing which I want to remind from last time is that basically the dark matter particles are in the galaxy are distributed and, with a velocity profile, which is typically can be modeled as Maxwell-Boltzmann, with a typical velocity that you remember from last time is centered around, say, 220 or 270 kilometers per second, which means essentially 10 to the minus 3 the speed of light. So basically, we can assume that dark matter particles are at rest. They are highly non-relativistic in the galaxy, so they're essentially at rest when they annihilate. So basically, the energy, it's only their mass. And so the energy of the products that come out is typically corresponding to the rest mass of the dark matter particles in the initial state. So you will have boosted particles with the kinetic energy that corresponds to the dark matter mass in the initial state. There is no kinetic energy in the initial state, essentially. Now remember that here I'm a bit biased, eh? So as I said last time, I'm mostly focusing on, say, WIMPs particles, so typically 100 GeV mass with roughly weak interactions. So things are not completely general. There are other cases in which what I'm saying is not valid and something else happens. But in this regime, yes. Okay, so let me look a little bit more into the production process, so the annihilation or decay or decay of dark matter particles. So the plot is that one, and the completely model independent plot is that one. But of course, I can have in each specific model, I can have some specific diagrams happening. So for instance, I can have an annihilation of dark matter particles through a T channel into, say, B quarks, B and TB, and this will be a squark, a bottom, say, for instance, in supersymmetry. Or you can have annihilation again into the T channel into W plus and W minus. So this is what something that you would expect if dark matter is a WIMP, so interacts with interaction. So this could be something like a chargino, I don't know. Or you can have annihilations into, like, very simply a Z boson that decays into two leptons, say, or something like this. I don't know, maybe for instance, mu plus mu minus or something of this sort. So the different processes will be dictated by the particle physics model which is behind. So typically, these in a given model, these will intervene. Some of them will intervene, possibly with different branching ratios. So different weights, different relative weights in the annihilation process. So let's say you have to combine, if you want to have the whole production process, you have to combine the different channels into which dark matter particles are annihilating, weighting them with the branching ratio, with the corresponding branching ratio. So the total rate, say, of annihilation in a realistic model will be given by the sum over the different channels, the branching ratio in channel I multiplied by the ratio by the annihilation rate in a specific channel I. And these branching ratios I, BRI, and which channels intervene is determined by your particle physics model. So I don't want to go into that at all. I want to remain completely model independent, so I will consider different possible annihilation channels, all possible standard model particles, without committing to any specific microphysics, say. So let me make you an example. So how can I get those particles there if I annihilate in a typical channel which is W plus W minus? Well, just to give you an idea, suppose that from that blob there, I have a W that comes out, say a W plus for the finiteness. So as I was saying, this W plus will do whatever it has to do according to standard model physics. So for instance, in some occasions, it will decay into a pair of quarks, right? So an up and an anti-W, and then anti-down if I'm looking at W plus. So these pair of quarks will hadronize and will produce, typically among other things, pi zeros or pi plus pi minus from all the other quarks that come from this showering process. And this pi zero, as you know, will decay after a short time into a flux of gamma gammas. So here you get some gammas from the annihilation into a primary W plus particle. Well, you can, since this is a charged particle, this one, before decaying, in some sense, can also decay, can also radiate a gamma. And so you also get a gamma from this particle directly, which will be possibly harder, so more energetic, because it comes sooner in the showering process. Or, just for the sake of illustration, let's assume that one of these quarks here, before hadronizing, or while it's hadronizing, it produces a gluon, say, it radiates away a gluon, and that gluon could produce jets of quarks that in the end will form protons and antiprotons. So from these kind of strong processes of gluon radiation or hadronization in general, you will get fluxes of protons and antiprotons, which are there as a possible example. If you produce a pip, for instance, pi plus or pi minus from this annihilation process, then, as you know, this will disintegrate into mu neutrino and antineutrino, right? It will decay in this way. And from here, you get fluxes of neutrinos, for instance, which are there in the example. This mu will certainly, at some point, this is actually my mu plus, so I'm looking at a pi plus, will produce a positron and neutrinos. And from here, you get fluxes of positrons, which are in that example there. Or I could go on forever. I mean, if here it's a Z0 that comes out from the annihilation channel, I could have directly the production of neutrino and antineutrino. And so I would have highly energetic neutrinos and antineutrinos coming out from the annihilation process. So you get a bit the feeling, no, from where these particles come from. You have first some primary channels, some primary particles, as we call them. So in this case, the W plus and W minus, or the ZZ, or the BB bar, or the mu plus mu minus. And then, due to simple, in some sense, standard model physics, these happen to produce fluxes of those particles that I'm looking at. So the dark matter process, the unknown dark matter physics is here, and it's one or more of these diagrams. While once I have these primary particles, all the rest is trivial, in some sense, standard model physics, all these processes that I'm able to draw on the blackboard. However, following this trivial standard model physics is not completely trivial. So what you have to do is to rely on computer simulations, computer Monte Carlo codes, that allow you to get the spectra of these particles precisely. So what people typically do is to use the codes that have been designed for collider physics, such as say Pythia or Herwig or some other of these codes, and adapt them to the case at hand. So you take the example of a W plus with a certain energy coming out from the annihilation process, and you feed it into these Monte Carlo codes and tell them, according to the laws of standard model, what comes out in the end? How are the spectra of particles that come out in the end? So let me give you some examples. This is what many people did. These are my spectra. Let me give you some examples, and let's have a look pedagogically at some of them. So these are, where's the pointer? So these are the spectra of three different species, the positrons, the antiprotons, and the gammas, from a specific, with a specific choice for the mass of dark matter, 1 TeV in all these cases. So these are the spectra, meaning the fluxes as a function of the kinetic energy of the particles that comes out, normalized to the dark matter mass. So first thing that you see clearly is that, well, of course, all the spectra have an endpoint, which is here, so at total kinetic energy equal to the mass of dark matter. And this is exactly what I was saying here. So dark matter particles annihilate at rest. So the endpoint, the largest energy that the particles coming out can have is the mass of dark matter particle itself, right? So I have dark matter annihilating, say, through steps into E plus E minus. So if this is 1 TeV and 1 TeV, the maximum energy of this is 1 TeV and 1 TeV. The maximum kinetic energy of this is 1 TeV and 1 TeV. Right, so there is an endpoint there, clearly. And then you can see that the spectra have different shapes depending on which primary particle I've chosen. So take, for instance, the spectra of positrons. So you see that if I annihilate directly into E plus E minus, I have, let me reproduce it here just for the sake of illustration. So as a function of the energy, this is the dN over dE. Actually, well, it's a log, but it doesn't matter. If I annihilate directly into E plus E minus, so if the annihilation is this one here at the first step, so E plus E minus comes out from here, what you have is the light green line that you see there, so essentially a spike around the mass of dark matter. Absolutely expected, no? So you have dark matter annihilating directly into this, so you expect to have very energetic electrons and positrons that come out from the annihilation there. If you instead annihilate into, let's take another color, you annihilate into BB bar, so this kind of process, for instance, then before you produce electrons and positrons, you have to go through these hadronization channels. And so in the end, you will get a spectrum of electrons and positrons, so positrons in this case, which is lower energy, because you have to go through these steps that degrade the energy, and with a shape which is much smoother and softer, rather than having just a peak there. Well, the case of the W is particularly instructive, so let me look at it. The W is this one here, so the dash blue line. I don't know if you can see it. Let me reproduce it here in blue, because we want to be precise. So you have a peak here, and then a shoulder like this, if you can track the shape there. Is this easy to understand? Yeah, it's very easy to understand, because if you have dark matter that annihilates into W plus W minus, you have the cases in which this, say the W plus, annihilates directly, first step, into a positron and a neutrino, and this is the high energy positrons which are contributing to this peak. But then you have all the cases in which instead this goes into quarks or something else, and then after the chain, these quarks will produce electrons and positrons for you, and this is the peak at lower energy. So indeed, you do expect that for Ws you have a sort of double bump with a peak there and a lower energy hump. So basically, the particle physics parameters that I'm using here are just the dark matter mass that gives me the endpoint of the spectrum, and the different choices of the channels that are determined by the unknown dark matter physics that give me the different shapes. The Graal would be to discover a feature in the spectrum with this shape or this shape and being able to say, OK, it's dark matter that annihilated in one channel or in the other. Is that clear? I hope so. Is there any question or any? Ricardo, you have a question?
The P bar spectrum is much cleaner.
Yeah, so that is another good, it's another good observation. So you have, if you want to produce antiprotons, so if you want to look at which spectrum antiprotons you get in the end, indeed you see that all the spectra are more or less the same. So this comes out from the Monte Carlo codes, but it's expected, right? Because if you want to produce antiprotons, you have to go through several steps of these chains and to get antiprotons in the end. And so basically the initial channel, the initial particles from which you start is in some sense irrelevant. You have to go through so many steps that after all the spectra of the of the antiprotons produced are more or less all bell-shaped and centered around a hundredth of the standard model, of the dark matter particle mass. So typically antiproton spectra will be less useful to distinguish between the different channels, but will be in some sense more universal with respect to the initial channel. Any question? There should be a question. I'm waiting for a question. Is there anything weird there? Because that introduces my next topic, or actually a side remark. Is there anything weird in those plots? Yeah, so the thing which is weird is that when you annihilate it directly into E plus E minus, the example that I had here before, I said that you get a peaked spectrum like this, the pale green line that I was showing. And you were all agreeing on that, have a delta function at the mass of the dark matter, energy corresponding to the mass of the dark matter. But actually, if you look at what happens below, you have that this does something like this. So there is a contribution at lower energies here. Where is it coming from? It's coming from what are called electroweak corrections or electroweak radiation, which I will very briefly sketch because it's a rather relevant effect, which is not which has been recognized only in the last few years, let's say last 6 or 7 years. So the idea is the following: that if you have dark matter, so I erased. Well, anyway, if you have dark matter that annihilates directly into E plus E minus, at zeroth order, you do expect that these E plus E minuses go away carrying the energy of the dark matter particles. And so you expect a delta function centered here at the production process. But the standard model physics is more complex than that. So you can have that, say, before flying away, in some sense, qualitatively, these electrons or positrons radiate a standard model boson, such as the zero, for instance. And you can have also the virtual internal corrections in the diagram that you have to take into account. So this Z0 now does all the crazy stuff that it has to do, so according to standard model physics, so decaying and producing everything else. So here you can have, for instance, quark antiquark pairs when the Z0 decays into whatever, QQ bar. You can have, and then from here you can get antiprotons, you can get pi zeros, and these pi zeros give you gamma gamma, according to the same diagram that I was showing there. Diagram, I mean, naive diagram. Or this can go directly into new bar, so neutrinos and antineutrinos. Or this can go into mu plus mu minus, and these in the end will go into E plus E minuses. So you see that adding electroweak corrections implies that the naive delta function spectrum for electrons and positrons that you were expecting here is completely transformed. You have other species appearing, for instance, you have from a purely leptonic initial channel, E plus E minus, you can get antiprotons through this process. And indeed, notice that you have a spectrum of antiprotons from the E plus E minus channel, that green line there. And the spectra are different with respect to the naive initial interpretation, say. For instance, in particular, these low-energy electrons and positrons that come after these steps are what is populating this low-energy shoulder in the plot that you see there, and it was and that I was representing here. So electroweak radiation is an important process which has to be taken into account if you want to have a reliable spectrum. Well, you might say, okay, but this is clearly a suppressed process because I have to emit a Z0 or a W boson. In general, an electroweak boson. So I will have to pay a price due to the small probability of this process, so a price proportional to alpha electroweak, right? So that is indeed true. So let's say that the variation of the cross-section of annihilation in presence of electroweak correction with respect of the one without electroweak correction, so with electroweak corrections with respect to without, to the total, will be proportional, as you naively expect, to alpha electroweak power 2. So you have to pay a price. Alpha electroweak is a small number. It's, well, not power 2, let's say. If I do it, it should be like this. This is a small number of the order of, say, 0.03 or something like this, just the electroweak gauge coupling. But then this kind of radiation will be multiplied by typically a log of a different scale of masses. How did I call the dark matter mass usually? MDM, divided by the mass of the electroweak boson, say the mass of the Z, typically at the power 2. So the process, the electroweak radiation process, is multiplied by a log of the scale of masses involved. The mass of the dark matter, which is the energy in the center of mass and the mass of the radiated boson, in particular, say, the Z or any electroweak gauge boson. And if you're considering a heavy dark matter, say, of the order of 1 TeV, so if when this is 1 TeV, roughly, which is the typical weak scale mass, this is 100 GeV or something like that, you do your computation, and this one comes out to be something of the order of 25. Just do this, the ratio. So you see that in the end, this correction can be order one. So yeah, it's true that you have to pay an extra price. And so this process will be suppressed. But if you are looking at large dark matter, if you are dealing with particles of dark matter that have a TeV or multi-TeV mass, there is a compensating factor of the suppression, which is the log here at, in first order, that indeed compensates the smallness of the extra price that you have to pay. And the total is order one. So this process has to be taken into account, is as important as the other, as the zeroth order. So this is particularly relevant, and people started including it in the last, again, 6 or 7 years, probably more. Now it's also included in the Monte Carlo codes, such as Pythia, that I was mentioning. It was not until a few years ago, but now in most cases it's also already included, because indeed it's standard model physics that was just not recognized to be relevant, but it is as soon as you go to TeV or multi-TeV masses. There is another footnote that I want to make. So this is, I will skip this for the sake of time. Okay, so I have the fluxes of charged particles and gamma rays as produced in the nucleation process. And now I want to collect them, propagate them in the galaxy, and collect them in some way. Okay? So while I erase, if there are any questions. Oh, I should not have erased the galaxy. Okay, let me first talk about the propagation in the galaxy. Of charged cosmic rays. Because it's a bit more complex, actually it's much more complex, and so let's first talk about this. So charged cosmic rays essentially means positrons and antiprotons, and then also the electrons, the protons, the antideuterium, whatever else. But our good examples are positrons and antiprotons. So again, the cartoon picture, I should have left the galaxy, is that this is the disk of the galaxy. And here is the spherical blob of dark matter around it. So I have annihilations happening anywhere. And I have the fluxes of, say, positrons or antiprotons traveling in the magnetic field of the galaxy, in the turbulent magnetic field of the galaxy, and getting to us. So what I want to do is to write down an equation that tells me how the spectrum of these charged particles, so say positrons or antiprotons, evolves while they happen to travel around the galaxy. So basically, I'm going to write down an equation for F, which will be a shorthand just for dN over dE, in any given point of the galaxy, so x, and for any given time t. So dN over dE x, in any given time and any given moment t, I call it F, and it's basically the quantity which is written there. So I mean the spectra which are written there. Shall I put the black screen or not? You prefer the title like this? Okay. So what does F does? I will write down an equation for it, which will be essentially a diffusion loss equation. So what happens to these particles while they travel is that they diffuse, like I don't know, particles doing a random walk in a turbulent environment or heat in a medium. And at the same time, they lose energy due to the different processes that I'm going to describe. So the variation of F with respect to time will be given by, let me write down the different terms and then I will comment on them. D over D, E, B of E times F, and then I have so this is the diffusion loss equation that governs what happens to cosmic rays as they travel around. I would not be able to derive it from first principles, so actually maybe I would, but it would take a long time. So I'm just writing it down and commenting on what each term stands for, rather than going into the details. So this part here is the diffusion part. And you recognize the diffusion equation, like, I don't know, the particles moving, diffusing in a random way. So this is diffusion. And in particular, it has so this is the Laplacian, but it has a coefficient K of E, where E is the energy of the particle, say positrons or antiprotons. And typically, this can be parameterized as a normalization factor, so an overall value k0 times possibly beta, where beta is v over c of the particle, so the relativistic beta, and as a function of the rigidity r in gigavolt, it has something like shape like this. So this is the rigidity of the particle, which is r, which is a more convenient quantity than the energy, but it's simply related to the energy by the fact that this is momentum over the charge of the particle. So momentum is related to the energy. So here I have, this is the form that it gets, and of course I have some free parameters, which are this normalization overall, and this exponent of the rigidity dependence of the diffusion coefficient, which will be, in general, to be determined in some way. And I will discuss later how this is done. This part here is related to losses. So as I was saying, also in the introduction, talking about positrons, electrons and positrons in the galaxy, while they travel around, they suffer, say, several processes of interaction with the medium. And this implies that their energy is degraded. So they lose energy, so their energy is degraded and their spectrum is modified. In particular, you will have losses due to the inverse Compton process, losses due to the Bremsstrahlung process, and losses due to the synchrotron radiation process. So these are sources of signals, as I was saying earlier. We'll look at them possibly later. But at this stage, if I'm concentrating on electrons and positrons, they are sources of energy loss for these electrons and positrons. So this function, but first of all, it's pretty clear that this is the, so this function here, the B of V, is the energy loss function. So it tells me how much energy a given particle loses while it's traveling. So it's measured in terms of GV per second, say. So how much energy is lost in traveling per unit time. And it will have different shapes depending on the different processes that I'm looking at. So in general, we have a sum of these three different processes. Let me give you, for instance, so this will be typically the dE over dt, the energy loss per unit time. And in the case, for instance, of inverse Compton, this will take a form such as sigma Thomson energy to the power 2, and then UICS, which is the density, the energy density of the target particles, which are, in the case of the inverse Compton process, the low energy photons, the CMB photons or the infrared photons or the starlight photons. So units should be correct. You have an energy loss which is proportional to the Thomson scattering cross section, electron over photon, the energy of the electron or positron to the power 2, and the density of targets, which are, say, the CMB photons. So you can compute these. Of course, you have also the infrared photons. So this is CMB, infrared, starlight. So you have to compute all this in order to get the precise form for this function B of E. Similarly, you will have, if this is for ICS, you will have the same thing, another form of the energy loss function for Bremsstrahlung, an energy loss function for synchrotron, which are similar, with the difference, for instance, that the one for Bremsstrahlung is proportional to E and not E to the 2, to the power 2. And here you will have the number densities of gas, particles of gas, because Bremsstrahlung happens on gas, as you remember from the initial sketch. And here, instead, you will have something like E to the 2 and the energy density stored in the magnetic field, randomized magnetic field, in which the electrons and positrons are propagating. This is standard electromagnetism, eh? Nothing weird, just electrons and positrons, possibly also antiprotons, but this is not less so important for them, propagating into a medium and then suffering different energy losses. Then you have this part here, up to here, which is related to convective winds. So we're basically doing some astronomy at this stage. So convective winds means essentially that in the galaxy, you have all the stars sitting in the galactic plane. And these stars are producing, I'm oversimplifying, but typically they are producing fluxes of cosmic rays, of protons and other energetic particles, which are blown out by the stars themselves. So like the sun, for instance, is producing fluxes of protons that reach us continuously. So these winds will have an impact on the fluxes of the particles which are going around, produced by dark matter, in the galactic halo. So the free parameter here is, first of all, the shape, as you can see, this derivative with respect to z tells you that I'm considering the component vertical with respect to perpendicular to respect to the galactic plane. And the parameter which is at play here is the velocity of these convective winds, so how strongly these winds blow from the galactic disk in the two portions of the halo. And you understand that if you have a lot of these winds, typically, say, naively, one of these protons emitted by a star could hit an antiproton and blow it away or annihilate against it. And so if this is an effective, an important process, this will reduce the flux, modify the spectrum, and so on and so forth. Then I have this part here, which is the source. And I will talk about it in a second. And I have this part here, which is spallations. Which means the case in which particles, charged particles, electrons, positrons, antiprotons, hit the interstellar medium, so the hydrogen or the helium or whatever, sitting in the galactic plane, and do a spallation on it, like antiproton hitting a nucleus of hydrogen, so essentially a proton. So this is proportional to the rate of spallations. It's for instance, the process that I just said, say antiproton over hydrogen or antiproton over helium in the galactic interstellar medium. It's proportional to, I put here a delta function of z equals 0, just to say that this is concentrated in the z direction in the plane. So this happens only in the galactic plane. It's an approximation, but let's say here where the stars are, the interstellar medium is, the gas is, with a typical multiplying factor h, which is the thickness of this disk, which is of the order of a fraction of a kiloparsec, say 0.1 kiloparsecs or something like that. So a very thin disk full of gas in which spallations can happen. This is also an important thing, right? So if you have antiprotons flying through and crossing the disk, they can hit hydrogen and so annihilate away and they're gone, the flux is different. Or maybe they can even scatter on something very hot and so be reaccelerated and gain energy from this. This is called diffusive, it's called the reacceleration. And so different processes can impact this. The last term is the source term, which is just the annihilation process or the decay processes in the whole galactic halo. So the form of the source term for the case of annihilation is rather simple. It's 1/2 rho dark matter divided by mass of dark matter squared sigma v dn over dE at production. Okay? So the source term is just the for the annihilations is proportional, as you can easily understand, to energy density divided by mass, which means number density of dark matter particles, to the power 2, because you need 2 dark matter particles to annihilate and produce something standard model particles. It's proportional to the annihilation cross-section, the probability that annihilations happen. And it's proportional to the spectrum of, say, electrons, positrons, and so on, at the production, so in the annihilation process. Okay? So let me see. Maybe we stop here for a break, and then we try to solve this equation. Okay, so before we start to solve or understand how to deal with this equation, I just wanted to mention something I forgot to say earlier, that not all these terms are important both for positrons and for antiprotons, which are our species of choice. So let me let me briefly write down. For positrons and for antiprotons, in this equation you have diffusion, and this is important for both species. Basically, they are both diffusing in the galactic magnetic field. Then you have the energy losses, and these are important for positrons, but not particularly important for antiprotons. Just how particle physics is, light particles will lose energy by traveling in the magnetic field and interacting with photons, while antiprotons will go through like bowling balls without doing much. That particularly means that high energy antiprotons can come also from farther away because they can travel a long time without suffering losses. So typically antiprotons can come also from the dense region in terms of dark matter density at the galactic center and reach us in large amounts, while high energy positrons will not make it, as I was mentioning earlier. So we are still talking about indirect detection. And then I have the winds, the convective winds, convection. So this is particularly important for antiprotons. So these are typically protons which are emitted by the stars, so they will interact with the hadrons, the antiprotons there. Then I was discussing the spallations. and these are also particularly important for antiprotons. And then I can have also reacceleration, something that I was not discussed, acceleration in the magnetic field, the alpha waves of the in the galaxy. So this can be important for both particles, but I think mostly for antiprotons, but it's not something I want to discuss here. So basically, you can adapt the equation to the different particles and keep the terms which are more relevant. Now, let's try to have a look at this equation. First of all, we can say that the process is in steady state, so the variation of the flux with respect to time, or the spectrum with respect to time, will be zero, meaning that the injection due to dark matter of cosmic rays and all the processes have been going on for such a long time that the process is at equilibrium. So there are injections and processes going around, so in equilibrium, so this is a steady state. So I have to solve this diffusion loss equation in the steady state case. Now, the way we do it is that semi-analytically, say, we encapsulate, we make the assumption that the galactic halo of magnetic halo of the galaxy has a sort of tuna can shape like this. So I encapsulate the galaxy in a sort of box, of cylindrical box, around its central disk, with a typical size that I call L. So the actual thickness will be 2L, in which I assume that the magnetic field, the turbulent magnetic field of the galaxy, is strong enough to keep the charged particles trapped. So as long as they stay inside this box, they will be cylindrical box, they will be trapped and they will keep going around suffering these processes. If by chance they get to the edge, either the upper edge or the lateral edges, I say that approximating this, that the magnetic field drops to zero here and here and here, and so the charged particles can fly away and we'll never see them any longer. So basically I have to solve this diffusion loss equation with boundary conditions, which are that the flux goes to zero on the edges of this cylindrical box with the size L. This can be done semi-analytically, and I will show you the result in a minute. But before I do that, I have to point out that, okay, so here I have an equation, right, but I have a lot of free parameters that enter in this equation. For instance, I was showing before the normalization and coefficient of the dependence on the rigidity in diffusion. These are free parameters, I mean, something in some sense unknown. Or the velocity of the convective wind split by stars, and this is also something that we can have guesses on, but it's an uncertain quantity. Or even the size of this box that I'm drawing, the thickness of this box L. What is it? Is it a very thin box? So the galactic magnetic field extends only for, say, 1 kiloparsec around the disk up and down, or is it a very thick box of the order of, say, 15 kiloparsecs? So a much thicker box than wider. You understand immediately that this has an impact, because if the box is thin, then many particles will escape, and you will get a much smaller flux. If the box instead is thick, you will keep trapped many more of them, and you will get a larger flux. So basically, in this equation, I have some dark matter parameters that depend on the model of dark matter that I'm considering. And these are sigma v, these are the mass of the dark matter that enters in the different quantities, for instance, actually there. The primary channel that I discussed earlier, so primary channel, so the shape of the spectrum determined by in which particle I annihilate, and the density of dark matter as a function of the position, which determines how the source is distributed, denser at the center, less at the periphery, and so on. So these are the parameters of my model. Then I have some astrophysics parameters, which are things that in some sense we think we know from astrophysics, such as these quantities here, the density of photons in the background light, the density of gas, and so on. So some, say, astrophysical parameters which can be guessed or are under control in some way. But then I have some, say, astroparameters that we don't know, quote unquote, unknown, that I have to determine in some way. And these are essentially those that I circled in red, so K0, delta, the velocity of the convective wind, and the size of the box, L, how much the magnetic halo extends up and down from the galactic plane. So how do we determine these? Well, the basic trick, say, is that you use ordinary cosmic rays, charged cosmic rays, so produced, we think, by ordinary astrophysical processes, such as supernova explosions or spallations in the interstellar medium in the galactic disk, and so on. We try to fit their spectra as a function of these parameters here and get reasonable values for these quantities. So cosmic rays come to us in large amounts. The propagation part will be also governed by an equation very similar to this, just the source will be different. It will be, rather than dramatic annihilations, production in the disk due to astrophysical processes. And so by fitting, by solving this equation with ordinary cosmic rays, with the ordinary sources, you can get handles of these four main parameters that you would then plug into your cosmic rays from dark matter propagation equation and get the answer. Okay? So this is a whole business. So this is there is a whole community working on cosmic rays, of course, yes, a much bigger community actually than the one that works on dark matter, and in particular on determining the best values for these parameters in order to predict dark matter observables. This is an ongoing research field that gets updated as new data come out from different experiments that measure cosmic rays of different sorts, boron, carbon, proton, helium, whatever. Let me give you some examples. Some examples are here. So these are some sets of plausible parameters that come out from the fits of ordinary cosmic rays. So you see that there I have determined a value. Look at the first line, say, for instance, the one that which is called the mean. So I have determined values for delta, for K0 in some units, for the convective velocity, Vconv, and for the size of the halo, 1 kiloparsec for up to 15 kiloparsecs. So I take ordinary cosmic rays, I do my fits, and I get that...
How do you know the ray is a cosmic ray? How do you know that what you are observing is a cosmic ray or...
From dark matter or from ordinary physics?
Yeah.
Yeah, so first of all, the cosmic rays from dark matter, if we had detected them, there are a small portion to the total flux of the cosmic rays. And also, if we look, most of these, for instance, the one of the main observables for this kind of business is the so-called boron over carbon ratio. So cosmic ray boron atoms, nuclei over the flux of cosmic ray carbon nuclei, and this allows to determine some of these parameters, and it's actually one of the best handles one can have for different reasons. There is no way dark matter can produce nuclei like this. Dark matter annihilates into elementary particles such as this, possibly antideuterium, but you will never get carbon or boron from dark matter. Okay, so these are clearly astrophysical objects, astrophysical produced things, and so we look at these and others. But even if you look at protons, say, protons are enormously produced by ordinary astrophysics. If there is a 10 to the minus 7 contribution from dark matter, I can neglect it. The important thing is the astrophysics here. But, I mean, yes. If you want, let's focus on this quantity, which is uncontaminated by dark matter.
Can you give us a sense of, for that quantity, how is it dependent on L?
On L?
Yeah.
Now, here I'm not completely sure I know that whether this is dependent on L or not. I think this is dependent on, depends on a ratio of L divided by K0, or the other way around. So there is a degeneracy between these two parameters. So you need more than this to determine L or K0.
Yeah, because it would be strange for it to be only during K.
Yeah, so this is now, I'm going a bit out of my expertise, but this is important because it's a sort of ratio between primary over secondary. So we think that borons are produced directly, primarily, while carbon are the effect of secondary production, so due to spallations of primaries over the interstellar medium. Mm-hmm. And so this is why it's particularly powerful. But it makes it sort of dependent on a combination of these parameters. So you need more than just that in order to fit these parameters. And again, this is a whole business, and there are people who are much more expert than me. So for my purposes, this is what comes out, that I have different sets of parameters, like three here, but there are other papers in which you find six or ten or sets or whatever, that are different, but all fit the ordinary cosmic ray data probes. And you see that indeed, so the difference can be in between 1 and 15 kiloparsecs. So you don't know whether this box is 1 kiloparsec thick or 15 kiloparsec thick. And that will have a large impact on the flux that you get of dark matter cosmic rays in the end. Because as I was saying, thin box, small flux, most of them fly away, thick box, large flux. Not randomly, these are called mean, med, and max, because in this case you get a minimal flux of electrons or positrons or antiprotons from dark matter. In this case you get a maximal flux with these parameters, mostly, not only, but mostly dictated by indeed the value of the parameter L. So in some sense, this is an irreducible astrophysical uncertainty that you have to fold in. Later, I will show you examples of fluxes of particles produced by dark matter. And you will always have to consider, well, is this under the mean hypothesis or the max hypothesis? There will be an uncertainty related to the propagation history that will be unremovable in the dark matter predictions. Of course, the field is progressing. So right now, mean in this respect seems to be rather improbable because of other observables, while max is more in business. But okay, this is going on right now. So let's try now to solve this equation, just to get a feeling of how it goes, assuming that I choose a value for this parameter and that I use the values for the other parameters that I wrote there. So the zeroth order, really the worst I can do in some sense, so if I don't really know what to do, is to say, okay, let's neglect diffusion. Let's say that diffusion doesn't exist. Let's say that convection doesn't exist, or it's not relevant for the particle we are looking at. And let's say that spallations also don't exist. I mean, this is extremely drastic. So it's like saying that essentially only energy losses are important, and the source term due to dark matter annihilations. Basically, I'm saying like this could apply in some way in the case in which you have particles like electrons and positrons, for which convections and spallations are already not important, which are produced in a region in which there are a lot of losses, like a very dense gas or very dense background light. And so basically, they have no time to diffuse around. They are subject mostly to energy losses. Sometimes this is called the on-the-spot approximation, meaning that they are produced there in one point, and they lose all their energy there in that spot before traveling around. It's a sort of drastic approximation, not particularly physical, but why not? So in this case, the equation is extremely simple. Let me rewrite it down. B of V times F equal to the source term, Q. I mean, all everything else goes away, and what is left is just this, which you can solve immediately. So if I want the solution in terms of d phi over dE, so d phi over dE is the flux of, I'm looking at, say, electrons or positrons, the spectrum, differential flux of electrons and positrons as a function of the energy, and this will be related to, let me write it here in a corner, so dF over dE is equal to F, the quantity that I called F earlier, which is dN over dE, so the actual spectrum, times, you just have to put there the velocity, the speed of the particle of the plus and minuses divided by the flux factor, which is 4 pi. So I'm solving for this quantity here, which is the actual observable, the flux of particles per unit energy and per unit surface of, say, my detector. Velocity divided by 4 pi times the spectrum. The velocity, typically for these light particles, like electrons and positrons, can be assumed to be c, the speed of light, or 1. But for antiprotons, instead, it could be different. So in this case, you just solve the equation, and you get, well, when I write it down, you immediately understand that this is trivial. And I integrate from to so the solution is simple. It's just that I have to take the source term, and I integrate it between the energy E and the maximal energy at disposal, which is the energy of the dark matter. So I'm saying that the flux at the given energy E will be given by the source, all the electrons and positrons produced with any energy higher than E, degraded down by the energy loss, which is written here. At the energy E, I get the integral over the energy injected at the source degraded by the energy losses due to the function B of E. So explicitly, this will give you something like speed divided by 8 pi, 1 over B of E, sigma V integral and mass of dark matter dN over dE. Where I just plugged in the form of the source term for the case of dark matter annihilations that I wrote here. So not surprisingly, as you can see here, this is proportional to the annihilation cross section, right? It's proportional to the mass of dark matter to the power 2. So inverse, this is the number density, of course. So it's proportional to the number density to the power 2, which means that in particular, it will be proportional to 1 over 2 mass of the dark matter particle. But later I will comment on this a little bit. So this was the zeroth order approximation. It's not so bad, but clearly very crude. If you want to do something more realistic, say first order in some sense, then at least you have to include diffusion. You can neglect, if you're looking, for instance, at electrons and positrons, you can possibly neglect convections and spallations. But you have to at least include diffusion. So this term is there. So now the equation is more complex, and it contains this term, and at least this term here for the source. You can still solve it semi-analytically with those boundary conditions that I depicted, depicted there. And I'll give you just the result, which is similar to this, in a compact form. If you're interested, you find in the notes that I will put online all possible details. So let's write it, the deep flux for electrons and positrons, and then I'll write down the same for antiprotons. It will be given by 1 over 4 pi, 8 pi, speed divided by V of P. Okay, so basically you see that the form is very similar to the one that I have below, with the important difference that here I have a Hallow function, which is here, which is this quantity I, called the Hallow function, which is incorporating in itself all the astrophysical processes due to essentially the diffusion that I have reintroduced in the system. So this Hallow function in particular contains the fact that the source is distributed as a spherical blob according to one of the profiles that I showed before. And so this is the normalization row at the location of the Earth, but the Hallow function will be containing the actual profile row of R, the distance from the galactic center. So there will be Hallow functions for each different choice for the galactic distribution of dark matter, and a Hallow function for each choice of the propagation sets of parameters which are depicted there. Let me give you some examples which are here. So this Hallow function, it's a function of the diffusion length, lambda d, which is related to the energy. Okay, I don't want to go too much into the details, but and this quantity here is related to the energy at the source minus the energy at the detection, anyway. So this has the shapes that you see there, something like this. As you see, if I choose, say, one of the propagation parameters, I will have one of these lines. If I choose one of the profiles, I will have one of these lines. You compute these analytically, semi-analytically, by doing the solution of this equation. You plug it in this integral, and you get the flux of electrons and positrons at the end. This funny shape is actually easy to understand, right? So intuitively, if you have the mean case, so the thin box, then you have some shape like this. Nothing particularly special. So you collect, imagine that this is integrated over this quantity here. So you collect, your integral has an effective volume of the order of, say, 1 kiloparsec and nothing more. That is because, indeed, if the propagation is mean, it means that the L is small, so that tuna can box is thin, and so you can collect only from the local environment. The diffusion length from which you collect positrons is only small, so you only collect from locally. If instead you have a max propagation parameter scheme, the box is thick, 15 kiloparsecs, so cosmic rays stay trapped for larger distances, and so you can even collect them from the galactic center, which is located indeed at 8 kiloparsecs away from us, roughly. And this is the origin of these peaks. So we are seeing the large density of dark matter, which is there around the galactic center. Okay. So you can amuse yourself into looking at these features and the different contributions. For antiprotons, we have something very similar. So the fluxes of antiprotons are velocity of antiproton, speed of antiproton. In this case, this could be relevant because the antiprotons are a massive particle, so the kinetic energy could be different from the total energy. So this is typically not necessarily C if they are low energy fluxes. Divided by mass of dark matter squared. And then you have something similar, which I called R of K. And then you have 1/2. Sigma V V N over D E. So again, here, I mean, for the way antiprotons behave, as I was saying there, you can essentially remove losses, but you have to include convection, and you have to include diffusion, and you have to include possibly also spallations. And so the solution is rather different. I mean, it's still a semi-analytical solution that you can write down. What you end up having is a solution written here, which involves no integral, but it's multiplied by this quantity R of K that is called, in this case, propagation function rather than Hallow function. So it's not surprising that you don't have an integral over the energy, because as I was saying, in some sense, antiprotons do not lose energy. They just propagate around, keeping their shape of the spectrum. So basically, this is the spectrum at injection multiplied by normalization factors, and this is what you get at the end, rather than this integral due to the losses of energy. So the spectrum of antiprotons is not degraded too much by the propagation. This is these are examples of this function R of K for the case of antiprotons. Again, you see that the normalization is intuitive. If you have a min, this normalization is small, so you get a little flux. If you have max, this normalization is high, you get high flux. And this shape is dictated by the interplay between diffusion and the other processes. This is the first order. If you're really a fanatic, you can, like I am, you can go to, say, second order in some sense, which means that a simplifying assumption that I've been doing silently here is to say that the energy losses have a dependence on the energy, which is given by this here, and which is independent on space. So in this first order approximation, B of V is has a dependent on the energy dictated by that and has no dependence on space. So energy losses are the same here and at the galactic center in this approximation. In the more realistic case, B is a function of the energy and the position. So here or the galactic center or somewhere else in the galaxy. So I promote this quantity B to be a function also of the position. This is, if you think of it, this is actually needed, because the density of gas, or the density of the starlight, or the density of the magnetic field energy will not be the same here or the galactic center. It will be completely different. You have much more gas at the galactic center than here. You have much more starlight in this region than up there in that region. So if you want to be precise, you have to promote B to be a function of the position. And then you have a solution, which I'm not going to write down, similar to this one, where you have a generalized Hallow function, more complex than this, blah, blah, blah. So this is what I've been happy doing in the past few years. You find the papers on the web. And
what is the order of magnitude of the correction?
So typically, well, it's completely different in the sense that you have you have a different Hallow function for different, for. I have the plot. I'll show it in a second. You have a different Hallow function for a different for each different injection energy, and they do overlap with these, say in orders of magnitude, but the shape is rather different. Let me give you the final results so that if you want the final results, here they are. So these are, say, the fluxes of electrons or positrons for a specific dark matter model, for a specific annihilation channel normalized with a certain annihilation cross section and a certain profile. where I'm varying the min, med, and max, and you see that you get these different shapes here. So you see that the propagation choice, min, med, or max, makes an impact at low energy, but it doesn't make such an impact at high energy. This is what I was saying before. Since if positrons are high energetic, they come from local, from a local environment, and so they're not sensitive to the propagation choices. While if they are low energy, they come from a bigger volume, you collect them from a bigger volume, and so the impact on uncertainty is larger. Same if I choose max, say, and I vary the profiles of dark matter. You have a large impact at low energy, say an order of magnitude or so, and little impact at high energy. For antiprotons, the spectra are almost the same shape. Spectrum antiprotons do not degrade too much, but the normalization is different because of the thickness of the halo inside which I can collect them. And so you can amuse yourself to do all these things. The impact of the simplified or first order or second order is here. So the solid red line is second order, the detailed stuff. The black solid line is first order for med. So depends if you're really, it's a factor of two in this case, it can be a bit more, a bit less. Let's not insist too much. Okay. So the idea is now you have fluxes of electrons and positrons, and say you're on the protons produced by dark matter, you have everything you need. You can go and say superimpose to that an astrophysical background of some sort that you hope you know, produced by whatever astrophysical processes, you get a total which is this with a bump, as I was saying at the beginning, and you go and compare with data from, I don't know, AMS, the experiment on the International Space Station, or CALET, the satellite on orbit, or DAMP, another satellite in orbit. If you see a bump and an excess, you jump up and down, it's dark matter. Otherwise, you can just impose an upper bound to how much dark matter you can have, so how much annihilation cross-section you can allow. Let's move on, and in the last 25 minutes, we'll discuss gamma rays. I raise, and if there are questions, you ask. And then neutrinos, but just very qualitatively.
The cross section that you put there is corresponds to what?
The one chosen for this example?
Yeah.
This is 3×10⁻²⁶ centimeter cube per second would be the thermal cross-section, the one that comes out automatically if dark matter is a thermal relic in the freeze-out mechanism discussed 2 times ago. But it's just a normalization factor, so if I enlarge it, actually it was written here, right? So it's linear, the flux is linearly proportional to sigma v. So if sigma v is 10 times higher, the flux is simply 10 times higher, and so on. So it's linearly dependent. I choose this number because it's the cosmological automatic value that comes out.
One sees that the prediction that is more stable with respect to the model when you go towards the 10 to 3.
Yeah, to high energies, yes.
Yeah, why?
And this is what I was saying at some point, which is if you go to high energy, then the electrons and positrons that you are collecting come from a local environment, more local environment, in the sense that to arrive at one, they are produced at 1 TeV. Dark matter mass is 1 TeV. To arrive at you at 900 GeV, say, then they have to come from really local. Otherwise, if they travel too much around from a too big volume, then they would lose their energy and they would be degraded to smaller energies. So if they're really local, it doesn't matter too much what propagation they are undergoing, if it's min or med or max. and it doesn't matter too much which profile they originate from, because around us they are more or less the same, both the profiles and the propagation schemes.
So they are on the spot.
In some sense, in some sense, at high energy you could be in an on the spot approximation. Diffusion is not important. The only important thing is diffusion and the source variation is not important. The important thing is only the normalization due to the dark matter model that you choose. Okay, so gamma rays. And I'm discussing here, so let me specify that I'm discussing prompt gamma rays. With prompt, I mean those that come directly from the annihilation process. So dark matter, well, no, let's say that here I have first some primary channels, the standard model particles, and then from the processes I described at the beginning, you get fluxes of gammas, which I define as prompt. I'm not discussing, I don't think I will have time, the secondaries, so the technicalities of the secondary gammas, those from inverse quantum, Bremsstrahlung, and synchrotron. I just mentioned the principles at the beginning, but I will not give formulae for them. So let me be a bit more precise and say where exactly these gammas can come from. So where exactly the prompt gammas can come from and which typical spectra they will have? Well, one I have already essentially discussed, and it is, let me use this. So one is essentially this one, that I will call continuum. So in the examples that I gave before, this is annihilation into, say, W plus W minus, W plus W minus producing pi zeros, and these pi zeros producing a pair of gamma gamma. So from here, you will get a flux. From these kind of processes, you will get a typical flux of gamma rays that is a continuum, so a shape like this, with an end point at the mass of the dark matter, of course, as usual, and typical energies which are a fraction of the value of the dark matter mass, a tenth or a hundred or so. So this, I call it continuum in the sense that it's a continuum in energy because it comes from all these different processes, different energy for the pi's imply different energies for the gammas, and you get a continuum spectrum. Sometimes it's even called pi zero spectrum, in the sense that the dominant source is pi zeros from the hadronization of these processes here. But you have another possibility. So dark matter can also annihilate directly into a pair of gammas, right? Gamma-gamma directly. So this it would be great because it would give you a line, a gamma ray line, a more chromatic gamma ray line. So a spectrum like this, where this is the mass of dark matter, with an energy which is precisely centered at the mass of the dark matter. Now you may say, okay, but you have been telling us since 5 weeks that dark matter is neutral, electrically neutral, so how can I produce gammas? Okay, yes, sure. That means that in your model you must have a sort of loop of some particles, electrically charged particles, chi plus, chi minus, x plus, x minus, whatever, that are coupled both to the dark matter and to the gammas, of course, because they are electrically charged, and so mediate the decay into gamma-gamma. So typically, a gamma ray line will be much better in terms of phenomenology, because you have a smoking gun. You have a line in gammas, monochromatic line in gammas, which is very difficult to fake with any astrophysical process. Monochromatic lines are not easy to get in astrophysics. But the cross-section, so the normalization of the flux, will be certainly very reduced because of the loop that you have to introduce. So the cross-section for this will be orders of magnitude smaller than the cross-section of this. So you risk being below a background from astrophysical sources that you have to beat. Actually, you realize almost immediately that there's not typically, you don't expect just one line, but you expect at least a couple of lines, because almost always, when you have some this kind of diagram, you can have also an annihilation into gamma z, into a pair of gamma, into a couple of particles, gamma z and z's in the standard model. You can also have zz, but then you go back to this kind of process for the WW. And this gives you a spectrum which is composed by of two lines, one here and one here. So this comes when you annihilate directly into gamma-gamma. This line comes from the gamma when you annihilate into gamma z. You have to a smaller energy in the energy of the gamma rays given by, so the energy of the gamma that you get in the end is mass of the dark matter times 1 minus mass of the z boson divided by 4 times mass of the dark matter power 2. So this line here has a smaller energy. It's not just okay, so for this one, of course, E gamma is equal to mass of dark matter, right? For this line. For this other line, instead, you have a slightly smaller value because you have to pay the price of producing a massive Z. So typically, if you are annihilating directly into gammas, you also expect a sort of mini forest of two lines, closely spaced, depending on this ratio here. And if your telescope or experiment is good enough, you can even hope to distinguish these two. There are another class of spectra which are interesting, which are those with so-called sharp features. And these arise when? So for instance, they arise in the case of the so-called virtual internal Bremsstrahlung. So up to here, I've been essentially model independent. I've been telling you, okay, so I produce particles, but I don't want to know what's inside this loop. But if I have a specific model, I can have processes like this one that I draw at some point earlier today. So say that I annihilate into, which kind of example is it? So here it goes into whatever I want. And here, for instance, I annihilate into a charged particle of some sort. This could be a chargino or something like this. Then this charged particle, being charged, it can emit a gamma directly. So you can have an emission of gammas, not from the disintegration of these primary channels, not directly not as a line, but as a Bremsstrahlung, internal Bremsstrahlung, due to the charged particles inside the blob that I'm opening up in this case. So the typical spectra that you get for virtual internal Bremsstrahlung, you can do the computation, and they turn out to be something like this. So this is the endpoint of the spectrum as usual, due to the dark matter mass, and they typically have turn out to have a triangular shape like this. So it's not as good as this. It's not a line. You can spot it. It's not as bad in some sense as this, because you have a sharp feature that you can hope to detect on top of our astrophysical background, which is always there, causing troubles. Let's take another example. For instance, if you have metastable states, you can also have sharp features of this sort. Take, for instance, this example here. You have dark matter that annihilates in some way into some metastable state, into a pair of metastable states, and then these metastable states produce gammas. Okay, so this could be, you might say, okay, this is completely crazy. You are talking about science fiction, but no, actually not at all. This could be, for instance, the Higgs. So you annihilate into a pair of Higgses, and then the Higgs does gamma-gamma in some small percentage of cases. So in this case, which spectrum do you get? You can show easily that you get something like this. I'm a bit oversimplifying. So it's the so-called top hat spectrum. So with the shape of a top hat, where this is the end point. And these quantities here are called E minus and E plus, and are given by E minus and E plus, yes, are given by mass of the dark matter. This is just kinematic that you can try to reconstruct. 1 plus or minus the square root of x okay, so x is this metastable state here. So its mass, the mass of the dark matter, and 1 plus or minus, you get the two edges of this spectrum here. So this is another case in which it's not as good as this, it's not as bad as this, it's a sort of intermediate spectrum that you can hope to detect. Now you can amuse yourself and see that if the mass of X is much, much larger than the mass of dark matter, then the mass of dark matter is much larger than the mass of X, then we'll go back to the case of the line. If instead there is more or less of the same order of magnitude, then the spectrum is open. Basically the delta E, the opening of this gap here, is given by mass of the dark matter minus mass of X squared under square root. So goes to zero if the two of them have the same mass. And finally, since for completeness, so this is the case of metastable states which are bosons. Indeed, I mentioned the case of the Higgs. There is also the case in which these are fermions. How should I denote them? Like this. And these could decay into, say, a gamma and a neutrino. Some sort of fermion that does this. And the other thing exactly does the same. So in this case, you get an even finer spectrum, which is this. So with a slope that depends on the polarization of the state. Okay.
There is a problem with the E plus E minus and the square root. You should have something like 1 minus the...
Yeah.
No, the E plus E minus,
yeah,
the square root should be 1 minus...
Yes, you're right, sorry. Yeah, I forgot the 1 minus this. Yes. Great. Yeah, otherwise it was not coming out correctly. So this is just to say that the spectrum is an important feature. It's an important handle on the properties of dark matter, and can give you information on what's going on in the annihilation diagram. And it's also, I mean, the different spectra are relevant for the searches. I mean, this is universal, univocal in some sense. It's easy to get in any annihilation channel, but it's much more easy to confuse this with the background of astrophysics. This is instead a smoking gun. People typically talk about the gamma ray lines as smoking guns for dark matter, but it's very much suppressed by the loop process. And these are sort of intermediate cases in which one can hope to see something, but in this specific configurations in practical physics. Now let's discuss rather than the spectra, the rates, so the fluxes basically. Introduce a couple of concepts. Okay, so what I want, shall I draw the galaxy again? Yes, okay, so something like this, and the blob around, and we are here, and we are looking at, say, a region. Just to make things simple, I will think about the case in which we are observing towards the galactic center with our telescopes. So we're looking at the galactic center. So I want to, and this is us, I want to compute, to determine what is the flux of gamma rays as a function of the energy that I get from this specific direction of observation, d omega, in terms of theta and phi. So theta would be this angle and phi would be this angle. I'm looking close to the galactic center at a certain elevation and at a certain azimuthal, where the other angle that turns around this axis.
Solid angle.
No, not solid angle. I'm saying this is just a specific direction. One choice for theta and phi. So I think that theta, phi would be how elevated I am over the plane, and theta would be in this direction. Anyway, one specific direction, say, towards the galactic center. But this is one specific direction. It's not yet a region of observation. So let's write it down. This will be very simple, actually. So the spectrum will be contributed by each cell of dark matter located along the line of sight in which I am observing. So you have to imagine that I'm crossing all the halo of dark matter, and it's annihilating in all these different cells, and each one shines gamma rays in all directions, and I will collect those that come towards me. So I will have, not surprisingly, to do an integral over the along the line of sight in between us and the galactic center, and I will parametrize this as with a variable that I call s. Say s is zero here, and it's 8 kiloparsecs at the galactic center. So this will be given by the flux that I collect in the end will be given by the spectrum of gammas. The spectrum of gammas, so these shapes here, the dn over d, the different shapes of gammas, like those that I depicted above, essentially multiplied by normalization quantities that tell me how much dark matter there is along this observation line. So I will have to multiply by the number density of dark matter squared, so the rho divided by number of by mass of dark matter square, and here you will enter the profile of dark matter, of course. Then, of course, I will have to multiply by sigma v, the annihilation cross section, so how much annihilations happen due to the particle physics in these cells. I have a flux factor which is 1 over 4 pi, because each cell radiates in all directions, but I collect only those along this line. And then I will just have to integrate over the quantity ds, so this variable that spans this line of sight, along the line of sight, from here to here, and also on going beyond. Yeah, so the whole contribution, so the whole line of sight that I've chosen. Actually, to be precise, I have to divide by 2 to avoid double counting. Because I have two dark matter particles that are annihilating, so I have to divide by 2, and then I have to do the integral of along the line of sight. So what I get in the end is the final formula, which is this one. So I've just rearranged some of the quantities which were there, basically normalizing the profile to rho dot, so the density at the location of the sun, that 0.3 GV per centimeter cubed that I discussed last time, and normalizing the parameter S along the line of sight to the distance of the sun from the galactic center, which is this 8.3 kiloparsec that I've been mentioning a few times. But basically, this is just multiplying and dividing. Why am I doing this? Because it's conventional to call this thing the J factor. So this is the integral along the line of sight. This is the so-called J factor. that basically contains all the astrophysics. You see, so the particle physics is inside here and inside here, the spectrum that you get and the normalization due to the annihilation cross section. These are constants. And, well, the particle physics is also here in the mass. And instead, all the astrophysics, so how dark matter is distributed in the galactic halo, is included in this J-factor. So let me give you some examples of J-factors, which are here. So that is the formula that I just, wrote on the blackboard. You see that the J-factors are basically this integral over rho squared. So here they are, J-factor as a function of a certain direction of observation theta around the galactic center, they have this shape. So not surprisingly, if you're going close to the galactic center, you have J-factors. So the theta equal to zero means looking exactly at the galactic center. Theta equal to a degree means looking 1 degree above the galactic center. So you see that if you start going close to the galactic center, you have huge uncertainties, huge spans of different values for this J factor. Peaked profiles will give you a huge density, a huge value for J, so a huge flux of gammas. And instead, core profiles will give you much less flux of gammas because you have less density there. You remember the distribution of profiles that we discussed last time. So, of course, as Mark was mentioning, we are not typically interested in just looking in one specific direction, because no telescope is so precise for looking into one direction, and because typically you're interested in the emission of a region. So it's more sensible to define a flux of gammas, to derive the flux of gammas over a certain region, a certain observational area that I can call delta omega. Over a certain observational area, delta omega. In this example here, it would mean that I'm not just looking in one specific direction, but I'm looking at, say, a disk around the galactic center, and I'm collecting all the gammas that get to me from this observed area. So this is simply. Define this quantity J dagger, J bar, delta omega, sigma V. So I have here defined now this quantity J bar, which is nothing but the integral, so 2 pi divided by V. Omega, the integral of that thing over the area d omega. For instance, if I want to observe, this would be times j, if I want to observe, say, a disk around the galactic center, this would simply be something like d theta sin theta j of theta. I mean, this is just geometry. You do your math and you find that this quantity here, it's called the average J factor, and it's what's typically relevant for observations, because you're never looking at one specific ray, but a region, or a disk, an annulus, or a square of latitude and longitude, and so on. Here are some examples if you want. So this is a disk of radius 0.1 degrees centered around the galactic center. This is its area, and these are the values of the J factors that you get, the average J factor that you get for the different profiles, distribution of dark matter in the galaxy. So the game, again, is, okay, so you have a possible emission of gammas with these different spectra along from a certain area. go and look if you can find an excess or an anomaly on top of some astrophysical background due to, I don't know, millisecond pulsars emitting gamma rays in the galactic center or whatever else. If you find something, then great, otherwise keep looking. So in the last 2 minutes, I will just mention the case of neutrinos, but I will not give any formula for those. So the neutrinos are one of the other particles that I mentioned at the beginning as possible messengers from dark matter, because they are produced in the annihilation or decay process. Yesterday, Ice Cube announced that they detected a high-energy neutrino, but it has nothing to do with dark matter, was possible. So the idea with neutrinos is, first of all, you can have the trivial case in which they come from annihilations in the galaxy, like gammas. So they can come in straight line from annihilations in the galaxy everywhere. And in this case, the formulae are exactly the same as for gammas. There is nothing that changes, just the particle that travels is not a gamma, it's a neutrino. But everything else is completely equivalent. The more interesting case is the one of dark matter neutrinos that come from dark matter particles which are trapped inside astrophysical bodies. So for instance, the idea could be the following. So here you have the Sun on a completely different scale from that one. So here is the Sun, and here is the Earth. So as we know, the Sun is immersed in the halo of dark matter particles of the galaxy. These particles are going around, and it's the Sun is traveling through the wind of dark matter particles, as we discussed also last time for direct detection. So every now and then it can happen that one of these particles of dark matter hitting one of the nuclei of the Sun loses a bit of energy in a collision like the one of direct detection, and then gets gravitationally trapped and with some other scatters at some point end up trapped in the gravitational potential of the Sun. This happens over millions or billions of years as the Sun is traveling through the halo, and then you can have a population of dark matter particles, a density of dark matter particles that builds up at the center of the Sun. The same can actually happen at the center of the Earth. So there might be a population of dark matter particles trapped at the center of the Earth because they are trapped, they are captured as the Sun or the Earth swipe the galactic halo. So there, in the center, these particles will, of course, as usual, annihilate and produce primary channels, particles, which will produce, I don't know, electrons, positrons, antiprotons, blah, blah, blah. All that stuff will be absorbed by the very dense matter in the Sun. It will not exit from the Sun. It will be immediately absorbed by the matter of the Sun. But the neutrinos instead can escape, because the neutrinos have essentially no interactions with matter, in particular the matter of the Sun. So of all the annihilations that happen at the center of the Sun, everything stays inside and heats up the Sun a little bit, in some sense, except for the neutrinos, which are the only species, neutrinos and antineutrinos, which are the only species that can escape. So if this is true, you expect to see fluxes of high-energy neutrinos coming from the direction of the Sun, from the center of the Sun, and arriving to the Earth, or from the center of the Earth and emerging from the surface, from below. How do you detect them? Well, you put a big experiment like Ice Cube or Super Kamiokande. When one of these neutrinos hits a nucleus of dark matter in the Earth, a nucleus of matter in the Earth, it can rock, say, or ice or whatever, below Ice Cube, say, or Super Kamiokande, and it will produce in some cases a muon that goes in the upward direction, so that comes from below you. This is the case in which, like a neutrino, say a muon neutrino hits a nucleus in the Earth, produces a mu plus or minus, depending on whether this is a neutrino or an antineutrino, and this is the nucleus there. So the charge current interaction of a neutrino with the matter in the Earth. So the smoking gun would be seeing upgoing muons coming from a direction from below, so upgoing, coming from a direction which is correlated with the direction of with the position of the sun. Yeah.
But there are in the sun there are fusion reactions.
Yeah, but those produce electrons. Indeed, I was going to mention that. So the smoking gun would be upgoing muons. There are the possibilities, but this is the say the most the simplest one. Upgoing muons with an energy, say, typical. With an energy of the order of the mass of the dark matter, so let me say 100 GeV, just to fit the ideas, and coming from the direction of the sun. So this is crucial. There are no fusion reactions that produce neutrinos with this very high energy. The nuclear fusion neutrinos have an energy between an MeV and a fraction of a GeV. So if you see high energy neutrinos coming from the center of the sun, there must be something weird going on there. And that there could be annihilation of dark matter particles. There is a background, let me mention it, which is cosmic rays, the usual cosmic rays like protons, hitting the surface of the sun and producing high energy neutrinos themselves. So this is an irreducible background. Like we get atmospheric neutrinos from the atmosphere of the Earth, we also get solar atmosphere neutrinos, and this is a background that you cannot reduce. But other than that, nuclear fusion or stuff like that at the center of the sun is not relevant, it's a much lower energy. So just to finish, the important thing here is that, this is a smoking gun signal, but it's not so clean in the sense that you have to consider the propagation of the neutrinos here at the center of the sun. So they do oscillations in matter. They possibly can interact with the matter of the sun. Then you have oscillations in vacuum, the flavor oscillations of neutrinos that mix up their flavors. And then you have oscillations in the matter of the Earth that also mix up their flavors. So you have to compute all these things and fold them in and possibly get a signal of this sort. At the moment, there is no effect, there is no detection, so no claim of anything. So I guess this ends everything. And basically, good luck. So we have to discover dark matter in some way, either in direct detection, in indirect detection, or looking at colliders, at some different probes. I've been biased by saying that dark matter is a particle, but by now I think that you are more or less convinced that because the alternatives don't work at all, at least on all these cases that I discussed. I've been a bit more biased when discussing the searches, discussing WIMPs, so typical 100 GeV particles with weak interactions in a broad sense. There could be more general cases, like stellar neutrinos or axions and so on. So it is open, let's see. Okay. Questions or anything?
No, okay, so thanks a lot.